Hello, everybody. Good morning. This is week two, and so this week's objectives are, now that you've learned a little bit about community boards, about the community board that you've adopted, you start to find out about its district, you know, who are its people, kind of like what does it do, how does it share its information. Now we're going to talk about a little bit how kind of civic hacking in this terminology, this broad terminology called civic hacking, how that plays into what a community board is and how community boards are like what I would consider a group of civic hackers who are essentially volunteering their time to participate in improving their neighborhood. And so the first question that we kind of want to outline is like, what is a civic hacker? I'm sure you've all heard that, you know, like there are hackers, there are evil hackers, and there are good hackers. Mm-hmm. Have you heard that before? Mm-hmm. Yeah, yes. Some of you? Yeah, okay.
Not good hacker.
There's not a good hacker? Oh. Yeah, well, there is good hacking and there is bad hacking, right? And so people are hired, you know, there's this demon version of a bad hacker whose sole purpose is to steal all of your information and to do malicious activity. A good hacker is someone who does penetration testing, actually looks at security vulnerabilities within an infrastructure and helps improve the situation. And so that's the difference between a black hat hacker and a white hat hacker. So black hat is someone who's evil, and then white hat is someone who's employed to just look at the vulnerabilities of a system and hopefully improve that. Now, in that kind of like good hacking range, there are multiple types of hackers, right? So one hacker is someone who does their skills, hacking skills, just on technology. We think that there's a realm of civic hacking where you do the exact same thing on the good hacking side of things. You look at the problems, you look at the vulnerabilities of issues, and you use that for community purposes, right? So if you're a technologist or if you're someone who's really ingrained in a deep-seated professional skill, like you use those skills to improve your neighborhood because you see that there's problems, you see that there's vulnerabilities of individuals, and so you're taking those skills and putting it together. In the past, you may have called that an activist. We're using that civic hacking term as someone who's, you know, we're taking those same activist ideas and just applying it to the 21st century with a fancy new shiny title on it. So in the context of what is a civic hacker, you know, for us, it's anyone who's willing to collaborate with others as they address address challenges relevant to their neighborhood and neighbors. And so today's class and session is relevant to your second lab. So technically your third lab, because there's lab zero, there's lab one, and then there's lab two. And lab two is focused around understanding civics and like where do we come from, where does New York City's government get its architecture, you know, like what are some of the key moments in its history that have led us to the system of government that we have today with all of its features and functions and libraries. So I'll try to use a little bit of geek speak in here to relate it to operating systems. And so the one thing to know is that New York City's government starts off long before Europeans ever set foot in North America. It actually dates back to the Netherlands and a gentleman named William of Orange. He is more or less the Bloomberg of his day. Mm-hmm. He is a wealthy entrepreneur. Who's a trader. He sees that there's this opportunity to unshackle the constraints of the Catholic Church that had been governing then called the Spanish Netherlands, and he wanted a number of reformations that would allow to the liberties that we now know as freedom of speech, that would embrace commerce over clergy, the idea that business is the king and not the church or the pope or religion. And so he funds the Dutch rebellion that creates the first Dutch Republic in the Netherlands. And this is a time of innovation, the printing press. The Dutch embrace the printing press, just as we have embraced the internet, to spread radical new ideas about science and ideas about philosophy and just, you know, like the things that we start to know now as part of our modern culture were funded in part by this political revolution and technological revolution. And in that revolution, we have the advent of global trade. And so dating back before the Dutch came to this area, there was one of the tribes in this island that we're on here in Manhattan. It was called the Lenape people, and they had a very interesting form of government. They were very collectivist, according to some of the books that I've read. One of them is The Island at the Center of the World. And in that, the Lenapes felt that land and property was something to be shared. Property as in like private property, maybe individuals owned things, but collectively the soil that we would churn would be shared with, which it would be shared responsibility. And so when the Dutch showed up and they were like, hey, we want to, you know, come hang out here, they were like, sure, it's kind of up for everybody. At the time period, what's called the pre-Columbian time period, Manhattan was one of the most diverse areas where there were a number of tribes that were in and out of the area because of the water. The waterways were so fertile with shellfish and sea life, as well as Manhattan and this area, series of rivers, was a migration point for birds, as well as just an unbelievable haven for animals to be running around. And so where there was life, there were humans who were essentially existing. And this is this kind of like shared environment with multiple tribes living in this area led to the fact that the first people accepted the Dutch as part of just their existence. Welcome to New York. Let's live. And that is, I think, an interesting part of our history, because a lot of New York's history starts with the Dutch, and then rapidly fast forwards to the English settlement, and the Dutch, or the English taking over the Dutch settlement. And we really never talk about the first people that were here who were living in a very metropolitan, very diverse ecosystem to begin with, and who were very welcoming of what was going on. Now, the Dutch and kind of did some bad things, and you know, there were some there was some interesting legal precedent that was formed during the Dutch period. For example, Peter Stuyvesant, who was one of the more famous Dutch governors of New Amsterdam, once sent a letter to the Netherlands and said, hey, I want to kill all the Quakers in Queens because they're not willing to fight for us, but we have to defend them. And so why do I have to station troops and a military garrison to protect the Quakers when they're not going to fight to protect the neighborhood? And the Dutch wrote back a letter saying, I'm sorry, Peter Stuyvesant, but our law says that all religions should be respected and treated as equal, and that people are free to practice And as long as they're paying their taxes and engaging in commerce in a productive way, you know, commerce rules the day. So you cannot kill them. And that led to this idea that everyone in the kind of in the Americas, as part of our Bill of Rights, is that we have the freedom of religion and that we have the freedom of speech, which also grows from the idea that the printing press and we should be allowed to say the things that we want to say. New York in, or New Amsterdam, as it was settled, was also very unique for the fact that it was a port that was not founded on religion. It was a port that was founded on commerce, and it was founded on business, and that you're, as much as we like it or not, but it was all about, can you pay taxes? And you know, here, as long as you can pay your taxes, you could pretty much do whatever business you wanted to do. And so there's this really unique history that in this week's readings or questions that we're asking you will kind of hopefully expose you to that unique history. Let's see here. Let me turn off that. There we go. So New York City's history also has this first part of our it's just really unique parts of New York City's history that have really helped shape and understand the participatory nature of New York in a way that I think is unique in the Americas. So have you all heard of Big Apps as an apps competition? So Big Apps, I'll get to that a little bit later, but just to bring it up, is an opportunity, is a campaign that allows for competition, public competition, to look at public resources. And so after they gridded out the island of Manhattan, and they said that essentially Manhattan stands for the land of many hills. It's a kind of Englishified version of Manhattan. And so the land of many hills, if you've ever been on the east side and you've tried to ride a bicycle, you get to see those hills. Or if you're coming from the river, coming up to the central part of Manhattan, you find those big hills. The city in the 1800s decided that they were going to grid out the whole island of Manhattan because they were going to make it human, like with technology and humanity was going to conquer nature, right? And so the way to conquer nature is that they were going to grid out the entire island, make it flat, and just build on top of it. But by the time that they were working their way up into the 30s in 30th Street area, they realized that they would need a public space for the masses. And really, at that time period, it was designed for the elite. And so they were looking at how do we carve out this center part of Manhattan that would be a big public oasis. So that way, as people who were living in the slums or people that were living south could then travel north and to experience this a bit of respite on a day off. Remember, there were no such things as the weekend in this time period. So whenever you found your day off, you might be able to do something relaxing. But more than likely, if you were affluent, you had many days off. At this time period, they did a design competition. They said, what are your ideas to create something that would be accessible and refreshing and cultured? And these two professional amateurs who were passionate about public space design and parks and pathways and horticulturalists and really kind of like intrigued by shaping nature for public use, put in this design competition. They really hadn't developed a business by this time period, but the winners of Central Park, the design competition, all of a sudden found themselves with the winning contract because it was the most elegant. It really incorporated all of these different design aesthetics that you would come in off the street and then all of a sudden find your way into these winding ramblas and paths and tree line, you know, and that itself was an app competition, as I like to say it, and it was built for the elite because you had to take a trolley to come uptown. It would cost you a nickel, and a nickel was roughly about a week's worth of wages if you were working in one of the tenement sweatshops below 14th Street. And so over time, Central Park was democratized and essentially made for the masses. And so this is something to be thinking about when we talk about technology and we talk about media, is that sometimes media itself or technology is built for an elite class, and then through time it is democratized and is given opportunity to everyone else. And part of the notions of social justice is the fact that we're working to democratize all of the different elements of society so that way everyone has access to it. And so this is a key part. Central Park, every time you step foot in Central Park, or if you look at Central Park, should be thought about as one of those moments in time which was created for an elite group of people but was eventually democratized for everyone as we see it today. How many of you know Kickstarter?
Yeah.
Sure. Yeah. No? Okay. So Kickstarter is a New York-based startup that asks for, if I have an idea, I ask you to pledge $5 to my idea. And if I get 100 people to pledge $5 to that idea, then your credit card will be charged $5. And then I have to then build or create that thing that you just pledged your money toward. So the Statue of Liberty actually has a similar story behind that. So when the Statue of Liberty was first given to the United States, it was given as, okay, United States, we're gonna give you this statue, you need to figure out where it's gonna be placed. And so there were a number of cities that were debating whether or not they wanted to have this grand statue. But the catch was, we'll ship it over, the statue, for free, but you need to build the base for the statue. And so for about a decade or so, or maybe it was like 5 years, that it was just the torch was outside of Madison Square Park on Fifth Avenue. And people there was a campaign to raise money to build the base of the statue. And they couldn't for one reason or another. It was a very unsuccessful Kickstarter campaign until a gentleman named William Pulitzer said, I have an idea. I have an idea to sell newspapers. I'm gonna print everyone's name who contributes money to the campaign in my newspaper. So not only when you contribute money to the campaign, you'll get your name in the newspaper, but now you can buy the newspaper and you can see your name in the newspaper. And that was the trigger that made the base of the Statue of Liberty possible.
Some marketing skills.
Some brilliant marketing and business skills, right? But this, what we've seen, there are a number of stories in New York about the collective effort to pool our resources together, to draw on our neighbors' wealth or affluence, to our collective wealth, to do something greater than the sum of our parts. In Chinatown, there's these little giving clubs and there's this also amazing organization today called the Awesome Foundation. And what they do is that they, on a monthly basis, everybody comes to the party and brings in $10. And there's a fee to come to the party, it's $10. And then everybody who has a project that wants to present to compete for that $10 then competes for that $10. And then at the end of the party, everybody votes on the different projects, and whoever wins the most votes kind of walks away with that Kickstarter money. And that's part of the Awesome Foundation. That's a tradition within Chinatown of communities essentially circulating their capital and being ways to help each other out. And I think this is a really amazing story that I like to tell about New York, about our collective opportunity to engage. So now I want to talk a little bit about some of the struggles, the real tangible struggles that New York City has faced that has shaped our understanding of government. So one of them is the Triangle Shirtwaist Fire. Do you, anybody not know about this story?
I don't know.
Exactly. So there were a bunch of immigrant women who were working in very, very nasty factory conditions right next to Washington Square Park. And you can go, this building is now part of NYU. And so these women, the year beforehand, were protesting the working conditions that they were in. They were working 6 to 7 days a week. They had no time to see their children. The doors were locked. The elevators were locked. They wouldn't have time for lunch. They were told to then bring work home so that way their kids could then work on these projects. These were young women who were in many ways slaves to the economy of the system here in New York City. The following year, they are caught in a tragedy, which is called the Triangle Shirtwaist Fire, which is remembered every year, where a small fire catches some garments and rapidly turns into, because of all the combustible materials and because of the working conditions that they had been complaining about the year beforehand, turns into a tragedy where women jump to their death, or that they're stampeded and crushed in the staircases. And they had complained about all of these issues, these working conditions, the year beforehand. This is around the same time period that the suffragettes were asking for the right to vote and talking about kind of the inequalities within this ecosystem. And so the tragedy of the Triangle Shirtwaist Fire sets out three critical components. One is that building codes need to have fire escapes, they need to have doors that open outward, they need to be able to allow for exiting in an emergency situation. And these are some of the most modern building codes that we incorporate today in our city zoning laws. Another contributing factor, and you can kind of see it here, is that there's a water pump on the left-hand side that's finally spraying water to the top. But when the first fire response units arrived to the fire, they didn't have ladders that could get up to the top. They didn't have pumps that could squirt water that high. And so the fire departments were essentially just watching people burn alive because there was no way for them to get out. And so one of the things that came about from the Triangle Shirtwaist Fire was modern sprinkler systems and thinking through how do we build inside of a building the capabilities to sustain or keep fire away from people that are trying to escape. And lastly comes the modern labor law around the fact that people shouldn't be in these horrendous working conditions and work 6 to 7 days a week for a little pay, that people should be paid equitably. And this was all led this was kind of at the core of the progressive movement, or what is now known as the progressive movement. The Triangle Shirtwaist Fire's committee that oversaw the changes in regulation that should happen here in New York City and then in New York State was led by Al Smith. And here to the left we have we have two Roosevelts here. We have Teddy Roosevelt on the left, who ends up being president during the progressive movement. And then we have Eleanor, who really champions the progressive movement post FDR's death. And in many ways, she's actually at the core of the progressive movement through the presidency of FDR. And what's interesting about the progressive movement is that it becomes the foundation of where we are within the 20th century, where the progressive movement demands for a federal income tax, direct election of federal senators. You know, there was this idea that prohibition, you know, if we could get a temperance and remove alcohol from our society, that we would be a more elegant and eloquent, sober society. Women's suffrage, the idea of muckraking. You know, anybody know what muckraker is? It's using information to uncover and dispel kind of problems within society. Muckrakers are journalists. They're people who use freedom of information law. They might be a hacker. That is what a muckraker is. They believed in modernizing our society through science and technology, through the advent of cars, planes, steam engines, electricity, running water. Like, this was something very much at the core. The printing press, cheap newspapers, they believed in improving lives of the rural, municipal, African Americans, women. There was a whole component of the progressive movement. This is, mind you, 100 years ago, that were into organic food. So it's not too different than where we are today. They believed in strong government regulation, and they also believed in the power of unions to help regulate corporate entities as we're moving forward. Sadly, the progressive movement also had some really big disappointments. One of them was that they believed in eugenics and limiting immigration. They saw that those were core components for improving a healthy society, was to get rid of people who may have had some different types of deficiencies, as well as limiting immigration, because, you know, frankly, we have enough problems as it was. And one of the biggest disappointments of the progressive movement was the internment camps during World War II, where Japanese Americans were rounded up, removed from their homes, and sent to essentially internment camps, you know, to villages that were guarded in prisons during World War II, because they thought that they would be terrorists during World War II and side with the Japanese. And so while, you know, the progressive movement is something to be lauded for on a number of social issues, there are three big issues that kind of distract from that. And then what comes from that is this whole notion of the Four Freedoms. Has anyone gone to Four Freedoms Park on Roosevelt Island? So the Four Freedoms were brought about in 1941 in a speech that FDR gave, kind of warning America was heading toward the direction of a national war or international war, and that there are four freedoms that we should all hold sacred: the freedom of speech, the freedom of religion, the freedom from want, and then the freedom from fear. Freedom from want is the fact that we should have the opportunity and the means to get and to work, really to work for the things that we want. So we should never be in a position where we're desirous of something that we cannot achieve. Society should be built in such a way that there is opportunity for us to work our way up. And then the freedom from fear is that we shouldn't be scared of the environment that we're in. We should be aspiring for peace. We should be aspiring for that the world is a much better place, that people are noble and good, and that they are not directly out to kill everyone. And so those four freedoms, freedom of speech, which is pretty self-evident, freedom of religion is also self-evident, and freedom from want and the freedom for fear are the core components of these four freedoms, universal four freedoms, which then roll their way, and this is thanks to Eleanor Roosevelt, roll their way into the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, and are at the core of the United Nations mission and kind of our global aspirations now to recognize everyone as equals in this grand scheme of what would be the UN. So yeah, any questions on any of this before I start accelerating?
I had one question.
Yep.
About what you were talking about previous, like way before when you first started, about how technology is supposed to be, was made for like an elite group. I wanted to know what group that was that makes them elite.
So the elite group, good question. Traditionally, anything of value at a high cost is only accessible by those who have the capital to spend on that, you know, device. You know, iPhones, when they first came out and even now, are really, really expensive when you look at how much someone makes compared to how much that object is worth. And so, if you look at even some of the startups that are out there, whether Uber starts off as your private black car driver, why am I blanking on, like,
I'll chime in just because, why not? So I think in what Noel was speaking about, it's a great question, because elite doesn't necessarily have one particular meaning. For instance, I have described you all to others as an elite group of students, and that's true, whatever anybody's socioeconomic background is. However, in the context of this, we were talking about more elite in terms of, just in terms of sort of affluent, with the capacity, the financial capacity to, whether it was to live uptown, away from the tenements, when Central Park was first built, you know, the avenues lining Central Park, Fifth and Central Park West, the buildings there are the buildings that were built there in the end of the 19th century, and there are these lavish buildings. So who's going to be living there but people with the means to live there, unlike the tenements downtown? So in the you know, that was sort of their backyard. Central Park was their backyard. So in that context, the elite would be the people just with money. It's pretty much as simple as that, I think. But it was a great question, because it can mean a lot of different things.
Yeah, you kind of stumps me. Thank you. A plus. There are, in the work that we're doing, what BetaNYC seeks to do is mirror government's mission, which is to build systems and to build platforms that everyone has access to. And at least that's part of our advocacy role, is that we believe that open data shouldn't just be for the people who have the means to understand data, people who have the means to crunch data. You know, the data, i.e. government information, should be accessible to many different groups of people and should be translated in ways and made accessible in ways that many different groups of people can access it. And so that comes to the idea and concept about usability and equity in usability. And so elite is there's always that other, there's always that 1% who are have the means, the education, the capital, the tools to do something, and then there are the others who are always struggling with some type of element of that. But there's always this elite that can pretty much do whatever they want, and then there's everyone else.
The money and power.
That needs to be factored into the systems that we're building, the programs that we're building that bring about equity or increase opportunity for equity. So I'm not saying like Apple should make iPhones that are accessible and affordable for everyone. I'm saying that technology and websites that government makes should be accessible regardless of mobile platform, and be considerate of people who don't have smartphones, who may only have access to a voice phone, who may have a language difficulty where English isn't their primary language, where text messaging is actually a more accessible way of scheduling an interview or scheduling an appointment than it is to wait online 30 minutes to talk to an operator to then get into something, right? You know, like all of those platforms of equality, like as a technologist, you can think about those usability issues, and you have the luxury to think about those usability issues, and you should be thinking about them from a holistic perspective and not just say, the only way to get access to this particular government service is if you take time off and show up at this particular location.
Okay, that makes sense.
Yeah? Okay, cool. So, but great question. Keep asking that question. Like, actually, that question you can turn around in a number of different ways when you're looking at anyone who's running like a startup or something, and which is like, who are your primary users? And how do you plan on scaling out to the masses, right? So Uber first started off as a black car service company, so you would pay a premium to get a private chauffeur, pick you up, drive you around. You had to have the app, you had to have a credit card, you had to be then able to afford the service. But now, as they've worked their way through the regulatory system, you can now use Uber to get a yellow cab, a green cab, there's Uber Pool, so there's like a whole scale. And so questioning authority and questioning who has power, that's always a good question of like, who is your target audience, and then how do you plan on scaling those services? And if they don't plan on scaling those services, then you understand exactly who they plan on targeting that to. So, speaking about kind of like building ecosystem of advocacy organizations that kind of impact where we are today, out of the progressive movement, out of the work 100 years ago, you get the League of Women Voters, which are the descendants of the suffragettes who fought for the 19th Amendment, which is essentially giving the women the right to vote and seen as equals. You have Citizens Union, which is an advocacy that started off as a political party formed, interesting enough, by the 1% at the time period, the Rockefellers, the Roosevelts, the Carnegie. Like these were the affluent families of the time period, the elite, who formed Citizens Union as a political party to root out corruption and, what is it when you hire your family member?
Oh, nepotism.
Nepotism, and Citizens Union said, you know, we should have skilled, educated, verified government employees who are working within government. They fight for civil service tests, and they really fight for this notion that if you go work for government, you shouldn't be You should be someone who's smart. And this is actually fighting against how government was organized through the different clubs and through the different parties, you know, 100 some odd years ago, where if you wanted a job, you know, you just call up Uncle So-and-so, and Uncle So-and-so has a series of gigs, a street cleaning gigs. And, you know, like, if you need a job, you call up Uncle So-and-so, he'll get you a job, knowing that you then have to go out and do a bunch of other work for them. And so this collection of groups kind of grow from the progressive movement and kind of are now working toward the city's open data law under the Transparency Working Group, strengthening the city's open data law, strengthening opportunity for transparency within government. And there are also academic organizations that are out there, like GovLab and CUSP, that are fighting to bring about government information. One of those tools is the public advocate. Do you all know the public advocate? So when you vote in New York City's government, there are two citywide positions that you can vote for. One is the mayor, and then the other is the public advocate. And the public advocate is a very unique role in New York City government. It's if not the only role within New York City. The public advocate is headquartered in this particular building that can sue the city for reforms and changes. And under the umbrella of what the public advocate does is COPIC. And COPIC is the Citizens Commission, Commission on Public Information and, or is it Citizens? No, it's Commission on Public Information and Communication. Yeah, Citizens Commission. Commission on Public Information and Communication. Commission on Public Information and Communication. And the public advocate oversees this infrastructure around making sure that the city can share its information in an accessible way. Now, in addition to the public advocate, you have the mayor as our two citywide positions. The mayor, of course, has oversight of a very, very large budget. Does anybody know how much New York City's budget is? To give me some numbers. How much do you think New York City's budget is?
Annual budget?
Yeah.
She's a finance girl. Let's see what she's
oh
got.
Oh my
to
god.
Say.
I don't know. It's so difficult. New York City's budget.
Give me a number.
$1 million? Billion.
$1 billion? More.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking, billion too.
$22 billion.
$22 billion? Less.
Like 15? 5 billion? 3 billion?
More than five.
Seven.
$8.2 billion.
My next guess was eight.
$8.2 billion.
That's incredible.
That's a lot of money.
Yeah.
Right? And the public advocate only has a couple million. I'm not sure that they even, I think they may have a budget of like a couple million to kind of keep all of that $8.2 million in check. Now, a lot of that is like in pensions, and a lot of that is like in capital costs. But it's a really big, New York City's scale is really, really big, and our government structure is almost seemingly impressive. So, for example, 51% of the city lives in or near poverty, which is like 6 million people. So the wealthiest city, the largest wealthiest city in America, is sitting and living on top of the largest poorest city in America. 1.1 million kids are in New York City school system, and if it was a city alone, it would be the 10th largest city in America. And that's just the public schools, pre-K through 12th grade. Close to 500,000 people live in the city's public housing. If that was a city, that would be the city of Atlanta. 700,000 people come in and out of one train station alone. 700,000 people come in and out of Grand Central Station on a daily basis. That's more than the city of Boston coming in and out of one train station a day. Like, just to think about the scale of infrastructure that you have to compensate for. And then what's crazy, this is the statistic that I love, is that there's 18,000 miles of pavement and sidewalk. And that's enough miles to take you from here to Hawaii, to come back, to go back to Hawaii, and then end up in San Francisco.
It'd be better to go somewhere else if you're going back and forth.
Sure, but just to think about like the distance, you know, like the distance of where it is from one side of the United States to the 50th state, which is in the Pacific Ocean, to then come back and then go back and then still cross the Pacific Ocean, right? That's the amount of sidewalk. That's just the length of sidewalk and road that our Department of Transportation has to take care of. That doesn't factor into the width of the sidewalk and the amount of concrete and asphalt that the city has to maintain. So in that, you know, not only are there advocacy groups that are around there that are working tirelessly to improve city's government, but we have professional organizations like Gizmo, which are you know, very much what I would call BetaNYC's older brothers and sisters or aunts and uncles. They are they started in 1990. They were a series of GIS professionals. Everybody know what GIS stands for?
Geographic Information System.
Correct. So it's a way of using data and spatial data to understand the space that you're in, right? So it's a whole complex. What is it? How do you call it GIS? It's like not just a profession, but it's a practice, right? So you can get certifications, you can get degrees in GIS. And these people are the GIS community in New York City really did the hardest work imaginable, which was prove the concept that data integrated through multi-spatial layers would really help save the city money. And so a lot of the advocacy work that we now do and the work that we're going to be doing through this program is based off of the advocacy and work that the New York City.government GIS professionals went through, what is that, 30 years ago? And advocating for the fact that data systems needed to be integrated and we needed to have clean and good data. And so some of the things that we'll look at are Lion and Pluto that come from the advocacy work that Gizmo put together. Now, what's also interesting is that you've started looking at community boards, and community boards were actually founded in the 1950s, and then they were reorganized in the 1990s. And as we said, you know, they have the responsibility of 150 to 200,000 New Yorkers. They focus on land use, zoning, community budget needs, and service delivery oversight. You know, these community boards are critical to understanding how the future of New York City could exist if we really invested in the people. New York City's Commission on Public Information and Communication. There we go. This is with COPIC. New York City's history. So I should point out, there are not that many cities that have invested in its citizens in the same way that community boards exist. Very few cities entrust their government to the people to actually govern, and it's surprising. Other elements of now I'm going to get into a little bit about policy changes and the creation of how open data has affected our understanding of where we are. So in 1993, the city, through the COPIC, the Commission on Public Information and Communication, published the very first public data directory. Now, this was a phone book that listed all of the data sets, the year that that application and program was created, a little bit about that application, and then the contents of what was in that database. And this was a phone book that you could go to in the city library across the street, and you could look at it, you could find the data set, and then use the Freedom of Information Law and say, I want a copy of that data set. Please print out, you know, the thousand some odd pages or records, so that way I can have transparency on that. And this was published once, it wasn't published again, but then seeds, the people who were working on this seed the understanding that public information, not just as a phone directory, but the data that's underlying that should be accessible to the general public. And so we end up with the Gale, the Manhattan Borough President, when she was a city council member, was part of a team that helped create and advocate for COPIC. She introduced legislation that stated that all public information should be published on the web, accessible. Gail was an avid supporter of Gizmo and has been an avid supporter of understanding how to use technology to improve the kind of our ecosystem and our government. And it took us 2 years to get the legislation passed. It also took the creation of an advocacy group called the Transparency Working Group, which was a collection of blue-haired and good government groups that had dated back to the progressive movement 100 years ago, incorporating new groups like BetaNYC to advocate for this piece of legislation. And on March 7th, 2012, the legislation was signed, and it was Local Law 11 of 2012, and that became the city's open data law that stated that from 2012 to 2018, all data needed to be published or needs to be published on the city's, on a single portal that's controlled by the city, so that way we can have transparency and we can play around with the data. So, are you asleep yet? No? Is this interesting? Yeah? Okay, good.
There is,
it's the city's open data portal. nyc.gov/data. And that is the one website to rule them all. It's kind of like the, what's the ring in the Lord of the Rings? It's the one ring. It's supposed to be the one ring that
precious.
Every...
Precious? My precious?
You're precious?
Is that what you mean?
Yeah, yeah, the precious.
I don't know, maybe remember more of a Star Wars man.
All right. Well, yeah, it's it is the force that glues all of the city's data sets together. So if you are a if you're an agency and you're hosting your own data, you have to publish a link to that data on the city's data portal. And so this becomes you should have created an account on the data.cityofnewyork.us website, and that's the city's data portal, and that's where we're going to be showing you 3-in-1 data and kind of like teaching you how to use that data portal.
Is it reviewed before like somebody publishes it?
Yes, there's a pretty laborious review process. And over the last 2 years, the advocacy groups have asked the city to enshrine other review processes and other practices into legislation, so that way we can strengthen the city's open data law. But I want to, before I get to that, I'm actually going to end on that. I will talk about how culture change comes about within government, and then show how we end up with actually strengthening the city's open data law. So now I'm going to talk a little bit about how we come to this world where the data law is kind of like now in practice. So everyone here, I assume, is familiar with the notion of what is open source. Yeah. So open source means that the code is available for free. You can see it, you can hack on it, you can improve it, and you can run it. There is a really important book that comes out in 1999 called The Cathedral and the Bazaar. And this book is the foundation of explaining open source to the masses. The cathedral is this notion that it is centrally controlled. There is a clear hierarchy amongst what information and how, what usability you have. And the bazaar tends to sit outside of the cathedral, and things are more peer-to-peer. You can go from one shop to another. You can review what's being sold. You can essentially engage and argue or negotiate the framework. And so in 1999, the cathedral and the bazaar, so on this timeline that we have here, the cathedral and the bazaar is published. And in 1999, you get a synthesis of where open source is in 1999. This timeline, open source in the US government, is interesting for the fact that you have the US government saying at an academic level, being like, this is a really interesting theory, because when we have access to the code, we have fundamental transparency on the code, which means that we have absolute security on the code. And so if things are published in open source methodologies, and if we adopt open source, we can see the vulnerabilities within that open source, and therefore we can fix those vulnerabilities in that open source, and we can have more secure technology. Yes?
So at that point, how important was it though? Because it was like very most people, probably, it was like very few people who knew how to actually like code, right? Because it's, right?
So, can you reframe that question again?
In 1999, like, it was not like everybody was coding or anything.
Well, lots of people were coding by 1999.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it was more of a
basic language, probably.
So
probably language we don't use right now.
No,
it's not like everybody was. It was not very accessible for people, right?
Well, so in 1999, you start to have a number of systems. Like you start to realize that open source is a practice or a methodology that can be used within the production of technology. It's essentially like a collectivist philosophy in the production of technology.
Okay.
And so how do you build a peer-to-peer, a collaborative architecture of governance around the production of software? And that level of transparency within not only the code, but also then the leadership of how that software code is constructed,
yeah,
is open source. And so just to kind of like point, like all of these, if you go into the timeline, this, I love this timeline, because what you start to see is you see all of these academic papers that are published, and then from there, these little files that are up here are different open source applications that the government is funding to create. And so it starts off small, you know, there's this adoption, National Institutes of Health, US Army, National Security Administration, Navy, Department of Education, Department of Labor, Department of Defense. You have, or I think DOE is actually Department of Energy. So you get this really small kind of like, let's start testing this waters. But by the time that you scroll to 2016, you know, 10 years after this, you have the federal government funding so many open source programs because they recognize that openness breeds participation, and participation breeds security, and it's the better way to go about it. Now, this fight is still happening right now. You know, like, we're using Mac OSs and Windows OSs, which are primarily closed source, but a lot of the libraries that these two systems are using are open source. The Mac's OS is built off of the BSD kernel, which is Berkeley Systems Design, which is an open source kernel, which is one of the core open source underpinnings that run tools. You know, if you have a Android, Windows, or iOS device, those are all running open source libraries. So it's not that we're not living in an open source world, it's that we are living in an open source world, but we have now businesses that are built on top of that open source. So this core component I wanted to get through is to talk about culture change and how culture change happens through time. And so one of the things that we see here in New York City is that in 2002, Mayor Bloomberg, there's a fable of how 311 was created. And that is that Mayor Bloomberg saw that there were hydrants that were open and that were spewing water. And you know, whether or not the kids were having fun, he saw that that water was somewhat wasteful. And the New York City's water system is actually gravity fed all the way from upstate. So if you open a third of the fire hydrants, the firefighters can't actually use the water, and we wouldn't have water pressure in our water system. So he wanted to know, who do I call to close these fire hydrants and to make sure that they're shut off so that way we're not wasting water? And so part of that is the creation of New York City 311, which allows for the public not only to get information, but also now to report information. Just as you would a bug ticket, if your application crashes, you now have an opportunity. You know, like in the open source world, it's really common for you to submit a bug ticket or to submit an issue, like, I want to improve this. Well, 311 is now our opportunity, our civic opportunity, to improve the operating system of New York City. Now, what's interesting is that not only is it about civic participation, but then there's also about transparency of information, and done so in a way that's geographically oriented. So in 2004, I mean, imagine this, in 2004, 12 years ago, before we had Google Maps, right? I don't know how many of you were using mapping apps, but back then, the only routing system that you had was MapQuest. And MapQuest, you'd get a direction from point A to point B, and then you'd print out the maps, because we didn't have mobile phones. So New York City was innovative in the way that it was thinking about that people wanted to look at this information from a geospatial framework, and they launched nyc.gov/maps, which was known as Nice Map, I believe, and has since been, this has been critical to understanding how do New Yorkers view government information. In 2004, Transportation Alternatives, which is an advocacy organization that helped push through Vision Zero as part of de Blasio's primary flagship initiative, also created a map. They also recognized that mapping information and putting it into the hands of people would be a powerful advocacy tool. So here we have CrashStat. This site has now been depreciated because of the city's Vision Zero map. But this was their effort. They had to go through a laborious process of taking this information, using the Freedom of Information Law, getting that data in paper format, transcribing that to an Excel spreadsheet, then mapping that Excel spreadsheet onto a web map, and then pointing out, like, hey, you know, right here, this is our neighborhood right alone, right? Pedestrians that have been hit at right in front of One Center Street is this big blue dot. And this is in 1995, all along Chambers Street, you can see that this is a very pedestrian, dangerous area. The black spots with the person inside of that is where pedestrians have been killed in this by vehicles. And so this map makes it very, very clear that in the congested part of Lower Manhattan, particularly, you know, this is in 1995, you have Church and Leonard, where you have what appears to be a pedestrian, a cyclist, and then someone else, have all been killed from 1995 to 2009, and that somebody should be thinking about making these streets safer to walk around. But this is all before Google Maps. This is what Google Maps looked like in 2005. Now, granted, the other two systems were also rudimentary in 2005, but you know, Google Maps was launched in 2005. This was after advocacy organizations in New York and the city were already pioneering how to display information in a geographic basis. And for those of you that are nerds, like to think about like the scalability of these web tools, like this was all done before Amazon Web Services, before 2006. So beforehand, we'd actually have to stand up our own servers. We'd have to provision some iron in some server closet, configure it, install the operating systems, install the security patches, make sure that the network connection is there, make sure that the internet connection is scalable, and then start the development of all of that. And so the time to market, the ability to kind of do these types of systems radically changes in 2006. Now, what's interesting is that in 2006 is before the iPhone, right? So Twitter's launched in 2006 based off of the ability to use lightweight web systems like AWS. In 2007, the hashtag is created, even before the iPhone. The hashtag, our ability to communicate in a peer-to-peer way, is done in 2007.
Wasn't the hashtag, like, it's included into programming? Because it's like a note-to-self type of thing.
So the hashtag, so hashtags tended to be channels in IRC. There's a whole history around the hashtag. You have comments and delimiters in type of and applications that allow for comments and notes, and then but the hashtag as it was outlined by some people out in San Francisco, like there's like a whole rubric around like how do you use that on Twitter in a way to find other people who are saying the same thing on Twitter. All right? And then in 2007, in June of 2007, the iPhone is launched. So just to think about like all of the things that have come before the iPhone. And it wasn't, and then when the iPhone is launched, it's really just a phone, a web browser, and a music player, right? It's not much more than that. But in 2008, the App Store launches, which changes kind of like our ability to really think through like what could be done on these little type of mobile devices. Because now we have Amazon Web Services. You have this understanding of information or spatial information through maps. And so it's how do we display information in relationship to a map? And now we have all of these different social tools that we can launch and do stuff. And so I want to point out Twitter Vote Report as kind of like the first civic hack. This was a tool that embraced Twitter, that embraced Amazon Web Services, that embraced a number of different open web APIs, and used that mapping function for the purpose of having individuals document what went on in their 2008 election. And so I was honored to be a part of this team, and the fear that we had in 2008, leading up to 2008, is that the election between Barack Obama and John McCain would have a significant amount of shenanigans in it that would call into question the legitimacy of whomever was elected. And so whether it was the story of the voter fraud in Florida, or whether it was voter suppression tactics in Ohio in 2004, the question was, if we did a large enough campaign using kind of these digital tools that then had an infrastructure into legal protection, could we use technology, data, mapping to help protect people's votes and help their opportunity to vote? And so Twitter Vote Report, I feel, at least for me, is like the first true civic hack, and it's the one of those first true civic apps that was developed by the public in regards to protecting the election. Now, 2008 is also interesting for the fact that we get these app competitions that start to come out from municipalities who are releasing their data and are saying, we have a lot of open data, we want to see people use it. You, as someone who's a member of the elite, who has the means, the skills, and the understanding of how to take information and technology, produce something for either your fellow elites or for the masses. Because now that this tool, these series of tools, are starting to be democratized and become accessible to other individuals. And so DC is the first municipal apps competition through Apps for Democracy. New York City follows suit in 2009 with NYC Big Apps, and NYC Big Apps continues to run versus other cities have started to stop running their apps competition.
Mm-hmm.
New York City's Big Apps histories is unique in the way that it first started off as a way for economic development. The idea was, let's use this apps competition to create new startups in New York City, but it ends up over the last few years, from the last year of the Bloomberg administration into the last two times that it's run under the de Blasio administration, being civic oriented. It is focused on solving civic problems and addressing civic issues through either technology or data, and the creation of startups outside of that is kind of like the third pillar, the third big win. So those things happen before Obama is inaugurated, and the very first act that Obama takes is to say, you know what, let's create the Open Government Initiative that's focused on transparency, participation, and collaboration, that's really focused on sharing government information to the general public and figuring out how they can use these tools and they can use this data and they can use this information, and whether they can do startups or whether they can become better advocates, but that they have an opportunity to engage in government, like an application API, application protocol interface. At the state Senate, I was part of the team that got to embrace the exact same vision, where we did transparency, efficiency, and participation. So in New York in 2009, you not only had the federal government working on these things, you had elements of the state government approaching a more participatory, technology-driven environment, but then you also had local government. And what's interesting to read is if you go to the BetaNYC GitHub, you actually can go and see the archives of the different digital roadmaps, where you can see where government is starting to position policy and initiatives around technology and how that becomes kind of like this fuel for culture change. And how the culture change happens when bike share, when before it was called City Bike, the city launched a suggest a bike share docking station map that asked, where do you want your bike share? Here's the bike network, suggest a station, where would you want it? Once again, there's a certain level of accessibility that this was designed for people who were passionate about bikes, could understand the road network, and then also had, you had to be at a desktop computer. But within a few days of this thing launched, there were over like a million points and data points of people either suggesting or voting on a bike share location across the city. In the same year, the Mayor's Office of Operations and a few other agencies launched this Change by Us, which was a my idea to fix in New York City is this. This was supposed to run through a fairly intense kind of like, you suggest an idea, we'll think about this idea, and then we'll think about funding the idea in the same way that Big Apps was a design competition. This eventually closes down, but I should actually insert a slide in here about participatory budgeting, which is now the city council's framework of, there's a concrete process of essentially, there's a capital budget, here's an opportunity to suggest your idea on how to fix New York City. Here's how you go about petitioning and campaigning for that idea to be fixed. And then here's how you vote for it. There's this big public voting process. And then whoever wins from that gets that money. The ideas that have been surfaced through the participatory budgeting process then tend to be addressed through city council and through other means. In 2012, the city decided to put its rules online. Do anybody know what the rules are? What New York City's rules are? So,
is this Title
63?
Rules of the City of New York, Title 63?
Yeah. Okay. So, the city has a constitution, and it's called the charter, right? And the charter outlines all of the different components of essentially what the city's laws are, right? Now, rules are about the interpretation of that law. So rules are kind of the ambiguity of that has been established in the law, and that the city then specifies exactly what that process should be. So rules around sidewalk cafes, rules around licensing requirements. These are flexible. They're not laws, but they are seen as close to laws. Regulation around TLC, you know, like I think it's illegal for a TLC. No, that's a rule, TLC rule, that a driver can be cited for dropping off a passenger in the bike lane. But that's a rule that can be, and there's a fine that's attributed to that. But that's a rule that can be changed. So the TLC can change how much that fine is. They could change it as, it's still a violation. It's, you're breaking the law, but they could change it from $2, the fine, to $200, to $400, right? That flexibility. And this website is talks about how the city makes rules and puts them up online, and you can read the rules. You can make comments on the rules. When a rule is introduced, it has its own workflow. So a rule is introduced. There is an aging process that allows for public comment, and then understanding of that rule is then edited, and then there's a final commenting process, and then there's the final rules. And this website that was launched in 2012 allows for people to go in and to allow any citizen who has technology, or at least the capability of making the comment, to comment on the city's rules.
People who just moved to New York, how would they know about this? Or like, what questions would they have to ask to know about this?
That's kind of something that we're trying to understand. So these kind of like 2-hour-long sessions are ways of framing, kind of like, if you stumble across this video on YouTube, you'd get that civics history, and then you also find out about some of these tools that are out there.
Okay.
So, but you know, like, there should be a digital, we are advocating for a digital civics course that makes it clearer on where are all these things that are out there, right? From rules to legislation, to data, like, how do we compact that in such a way that you could watch, you know, an hour-long video and really understand how New York City is.
But I feel like an hour-long video would be too long.
Yeah, I know. But, you know, like, a civics textbook is how much longer?
But in order to grasp attention, you don't, like, social media, the reason social media has grasped everyone's attention is the easiest form of communication. Is because it's the short amount of time. So the brain gets used to the short amount of time. So anything longer, by reaction, you're only gonna be limited to the amount of time that you're used to paying attention. So to have an hour long video, some people, I can listen to an hour long video and go about my whole entire day, be completely fine. But some people, it's the reaction of, oh, it's an hour. Or even though it's for them, it's,
yeah.
You know.
Well, we're starting this process, and we're figuring out how to whittle things down into something that's a little bit more palatable. So how would somebody find out about this? That's a very good question. You know, where is it promoted? It's right now promoted amongst industry and people who are really passionate about rules because they're the ones who their livelihood is impacted by those rules.
Okay, but I'm coming from, like, I just moved to New York City, so I didn't even, it's like, I would have never known about this had I not come here. I would have probably found out the rules, like, through other means, but I think these type of things, if you really want people to know how to act and how a society is supposed to be run, then you should put the rules out there on a wider scale than just word of mouth.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Agreed.
I mean, since the beginning of time, there's so much information that the public is just unaware of. I mean, that's not new to where we are today. That's always been the case. There's always just a ton of information that people just don't know. So it's this disconnect there, you know? And that's part of what this organization and is working on is making that information accessible. But it's an age-old problem, and it requires, you know, now technology makes this potentially much easier. But we still need to figure out exactly how to do that, because just because it's there, it's online, still, how does the person know to look there? Why would the person even think there were rules to even look for in the first place? So it's a, you know, it's kind of a huge sort of, you know, quagmire of work, but that's what is creating, the motivation is because it's there and there's, but how, you know, and that's hard, but we're all here to work on that.
So in two stories from now, I'm gonna talk about kind of like some of the history behind this rulemaking process that I think kind of gets your question. But like in 2012, the participation or the infrastructure of the city had grown to a point where there was a certain level of comfort in using these web tools and working with advocates that during Hurricane Sandy or after Hurricane Sandy, when Lower Manhattan is without electricity, the Economic Development Corporation, who had funded the creation of all these different startup and co-working locations, partnered with myself and there was like this kind of like collective group that came together to address issues around Sandy, particularly to get small businesses and individuals to locations that had electricity and internet connectivity. And so we made the Sandy co-working map, which were office spaces outside of the affected zones that people could go to that could recharge, can get connected to the internet and start the process of rebuilding their lives in one way, shape, or form if they had been affected. If you're a small business owner during Sandy and your office was without internet or electricity and you were still on deadline, you were losing money, a significant amount of money. If you're a freelancer and didn't have that capability, like that was a significant impact. And so this was our ability, our community's ability to kind of work with the city to think through how do we get reconnected after after a tragedy or a natural disaster like Sandy. And so 2012 kind of creates this question of, you know, what does a 21st century government look like? How is it participatory? How is it accessible? How is it for and by the people? You know, how do we as citizens engage in this ecosystem that is the government that we agree to govern us, right? Democracy is about the consent of the governed. We give our power, or we invest our power in a handful of individuals who then kind of govern all of us, and not everybody has that say depending upon their status, their citizenship. But democracy is for when you're in a democracy, it should govern everyone. And then regardless of citizenship, how is your voice expressed? So one of these things is the city record. The city record is a 19th century technology. It is a newspaper. It is the most important newspaper you have never, ever read. Have you ever read the City Record? The City Record is a collection of the city's actions. Do you know what a change log is? Okay, when you update from the App Store, do you ever read the things that that have been improved on the application?
Yes.
Rarely. Last time when I was updating, I was almost
ready. Yeah.
Later.
Later.
Yeah.
Isn't it usually sometimes it's to debug something or to update their security?
Yep. Well, that right there is a change log of what's going on with that application. And so the City Record is the city's change log. It is a collection of all the different procurement decisions, which is essentially, there are three different types of procurement decisions. There's the procurement announcement, there's the intent to award, and then there's ultimately the announcement of the award. Then there are meetings, so every community board is forced to put their hearings and publish that information in the City Record. But all agencies, when they have issues that are coming up, particularly around the rules, are supposed to go into the City Record. And so the City Record is this massive collection of information, and it kind of looks like this, that is the city's change log. And it's updated every single business day, and it's been updated every single business day since the 1800s, right? Like, this is where the progressive movement, particularly organizations like Citizens Union, had fought for government transparency, and the tools for government transparency in the 1800s were newspapers and literacy. So those were those components that they were working on. Our work coming into this is around, how do we digitize this and allow, if you can't get access to newspapers, how do we allow it to exist in a digital stream so that you have access to that? And so we worked with a council member to get this piece of legislation passed, which was essentially puts the City Record in a machine readable format. And this is kind of like the description field. And so one of the things that we're now working toward is to put the City Record into a more legible format, i.e. something that strips out kind of all of these HTML tags in here so that way we can use a parser and get it cleaner. Now, the passage of this particular piece of legislation leads to two other pieces of legislation that were passed in at the beginning of this year. The first is the standards around geodata standards, and that is that the City Record had close to 5 different geographic systems that were being defined within this piece of legislation, or within this data, and it became very confusing for us to understand what does an agency use to describe that parcel of land. And so we worked with the city. The city passed a piece of legislation that now has a concrete defined geo standards, so that way when you go to the city's open data portal and you get to a new data set, it should have a very clean and usable geo data standard, which means that you can then map that information. And then the second is data dictionaries. When this piece of data was first put online, there were a lot of things within it that we had no clue what was in it. And so we asked the city, please help us by defining what is a good data dictionary and by defining what's in those data sets that you put up on the city's data portal. And so those are two pieces of legislation that grow from another piece of legislation, which was putting the City Record online in a machine readable format. Any questions about that? Yeah.
Is this a source code or?
So this is, each row here is a record in the City Record, and each row is what's called an advertisement in the City Record, and then this screenshot is a screenshot of the description field, for each snapshot of the record inside of the city record.
Yeah, everyone can.
Yeah, so this is, in essence, the source data inside of the description field of the city record data set. So some other things that that look at how the city is a participatory government, a participatory environment, that we're, how does technology, how does participation, how does civic engagement kind of like all intersect with each other? So one of them is the Trees Count campaign that the New York City Parks Department engaged in last year and followed up and cleaned up this year. So it's the third decennial tree census, which means that every 10 years the city goes out and looks at its street trees. And this was the third one. In the lead up to this, they looked at the tree data points that they had for the two previous tree census were not as accurate as they would have wanted, and the spatial points either put the tree in the middle of the street or put it at the building address. And trees don't live in the middle of the street or at the building address. They live in between. They live on the sidewalk and they live at the very edge of the sidewalk. So the Parks Department worked with city planning and Department of Transportation and Do It, and were able to kind of map, build a very detailed map of the city and where all the potential tree beds were located. And then employed volunteers who they themselves had a self-interest in maintaining the city's street trees. So these were community-based organizations or tree steward organizations who love trees. Because of the city's fiscal crisis in the 1970s, the city set up a participatory tree pruning system. So that way, if you're passionate about the tree in front of your house, if you're passionate about the trees in your neighborhood, you could go to the Parks Department, get a certification to become a tree pruner, and then be able to prune those trees as you see them in your neighborhood. So that started in the 70s because of a fiscal necessity to leverage volunteer talent. And over the years, the Parks Department has figured out how to grow that particular volunteer talent to the point that in 2015, when the trees count, tree census came about, they leveraged 2,300 volunteers to go street to street tree to street tree, measuring it, looking at the species, looking for the damage inside of the tree, and then putting that into a database. Then the Parks Department verified the data that was there, and then the Parks Department came to BetaNYC and said, now that we have all this volunteer aggregated data that we validated, these same community-based organizations and the Parks Department have questions around this data and how can we use this data from an operational perspective. And so we developed a whole event called the Trees Count Data Jam that took that public data and put it into actionable insights. And we developed a whole campaign around it. And one of the things that we discovered is that data release over time actually needs to be kind of using the human-centered design principles, which means that every data release is actually part of a, should be part of a conversation, and we need to be thinking about data not as these values that we just put up on a website, but that they need to be included into this broader conversation, because there's always inaccuracies within the data, but then there's also these transactional things that you want to be doing with the data, i.e. hopefully empowering community-based organizations to take that information and to do something with it. And then once they get insights from that data, how do they move forward with all of that? And then I'm gonna end with the School of Data, which is that the School of Data has now turned, it is something that we host on an annual basis. It's a celebration of the city's open data law. It'll happen in March. We hope that we can see all of you there. And this is an opportunity for the city to come talk with itself and talk to all of the users of open data on how data is used, how is data powering advocacy, how is data powering government, how are changes within government happening that are influenced by data or technology systems. And so last year we had over 260 people in attendance. We offered childcare. We had some classes that were running there. Some of that was a distillation of some of the work that you have. And yeah, the city right now, I think, is at this well-oiled operation of understanding how to use data. It's not perfect, and there's a lot more questions to come about, but its history of civic participation and inclusion and making sure that people have a seat at the table and have access to information is really unique in its distributive capacity. And you are at the forefront of that. And I hope that this was a good introduction to understanding kind of like New York City government broadly and how technology as a component is kind of fueling these different changes. So that was an hour and 40 minutes. It's not social media, but not hashtagable.
Well, it would be. Just for more views, put a hashtag that people wouldn't think of. Cool video.
Yeah. So what questions do you have about this that that we can put on tape? If not, we can start looking at and reviewing the second lab. Any other questions?
Do you guys want to take a few minute break and just let this information sort of settle for a minute and come back and think about if you have anything you want to pick up, or are you really feel like you don't?
Should we just
5 minutes?
Five minute break. Yeah.
5 minute break. Okay.
Bio break or whatever else.
How do we pause this?